Man, Faith Assembly, Winterville, North Carolina. I have heard a rumor that this is pirate country. Is that correct? I would tell you guys what, man. I have not been to Greenville in a little while. I'm from Goldsboro, North Carolina. Any Goldsboro people in here? A couple? Okay, I'm from Goldsboro, North Carolina. I haven't been to Greenville in a while. Me and my family had come here. I believe it's my wife's first time to Greenville. And I will tell you, we spent some time yesterday just driving around, and there is no doubt that this is pirate country, man. Y'all will let us know. I mean, we go around, and I mean, everybody's got their hats on, and it's purple and gold, right? Because that's all I saw. Look, yeah, all right. I thought it was Easter, man. I saw it purple and gold. I'm like, man, I missed Easter. But no, man, it was great. Pirate country. I am a diehard Tar Heels fan. We play today. All right. We play today at 5:00. But until I leave Greenville area, I'm an ECU fan, all right? So I'm going to just let y'all know. Go Pirates. You know, I'm with y'all. I'm with y'all till 5:00, till I get home, and then I got to take the purple off, okay? But you see, I am in the purple. I didn't do that on purpose, but my wife is wearing purple, so we are Pirate fans today. Thank you so much, Pastor Steve, for having me. Man, I tell you guys what, you have got a great pastoral staff here. Pastor Steve is just incredible. Thank you. Pastor Steve was one of the first people I met with. He's a good friend. He's one of the first people I met with, and he was one of the first people to invest into me and my life. And your youth pastor, Pastor Jason, man, he is incredible also. Just give him a hand, too. Listen, it is not easy to be a student pastor in this day and age, and I know you students don't know it yet. You got the right guy. Man, love on him. Let him love on you. Just an incredible man of God, him and Tanya, just great, great people. Man, I spent the weekend with the youth ministry. Man, where's the guys at that were on the retreat with me this weekend? Oh, yes, y'all are awesome. Just had a great time with them. Man, they blessed me way more than I blessed them. I promise you that, man. Just getting able to connect with them, just a bunch of knuckleheads, man. They're just awesome. I'm just, you know, I'm a knucklehead too. I love you guys, man. Y'all are so awesome. Yeah, if you were not here this weekend, you missed the treat. You really did. I mean, listen, I'm all about growing spiritually, but man, my love language is fun. I love having fun and doing stuff. I tell you what, if I got work to do, I'll stop in a second to have fun. I mean, it just, you don't have to work hard to get me off track. I promise you. So, man, I will tell you, you're in a student ministry here. Man, when Pastor Jason does something, you need to be there because you're going to have a great time. I mean, we had an awesome time. Sermon series is called Seize the Moment. Man, I was so honored when Pastor Steve asked me to talk about this because, man, I love, man, what a great message series title, Seize the Moment. To me, you know, I thought about it and I wrote a couple things down when I was doing it. It's about, to me, maximizing your potential in Christ. Amen? Like, maximize your potential. And potential, I was sharing with the students this weekend, I looked up the definition of potential in the dictionary, and it means capable of becoming real. Capable of becoming real. And that's what Seize the Moment is about. There is something inside of you maximizing your potential in Jesus Christ where you have something in you that is capable of becoming real, but it can only be accessed through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the only way. There are many of you, there are many people in this world, they will live and die, and they will never maximize their potential. Things that are capable of becoming real will not become real because they have not accessed the power of the Holy Spirit. Let me talk to you a little bit about my personal testimony, just a little bit right now. You know, I was born, like I said, in Goldsboro, North Carolina. My father died when I was 9 in a car accident. My mom's a single parent. I have a little sister and a little brother, and my mom raised us. And, man, I grew up angry. I grew up upset, you know. You know, I tell you what, there were so many people in my life that invested in me And I didn't want to hear about it. For the last 6 years, I have been on staff as a pastor at RFA Church in Raleigh, North Carolina. And God has used me all over the world. He's used me all over the world to speak into the lives of students, to resurrect marriages, to resurrect families. Man, I have been to Venezuela, I've been to Haiti, I've been to Ghana, Africa, Zanzibar, Ethiopia, Cairo, Egypt. I have been all over the world ministering and sharing the gospel and helping students to discover the calling that God has on their lives. You see, I believe our relationship with Jesus is not meant to be some boring, dreary existence. For us to truly stay, for us to truly change the world, we cannot stay where we are or where we're comfortable. God needs world changers ready to impact the world and defy logic. That is your definition for your life. God wants to defy logic in your life. When he looks at me, I was meant to be a statistic, but God used me to defy the logic of the world. And that's what he wants to use you for today. World changers for Jesus. When we talk about world changers, we like to think about young people. That's what we like to think about. We like to think about that little kid or that student or that college student. But to be a world changer, it doesn't have an age on it. You can be from any background. You can be from any race. It doesn't matter. You don't have to be young to be a world changer. And I believe that God wants some of you in here today to seize the moment of your life and begin to impact the world in a way that you never imagined or dreamed. Seizing the moment is not just about surviving, but thriving despite your circumstances. How many of you know today that despite the circumstances in your life, despite what the enemy's telling you, despite what your mind is telling you, despite what you look and what you see when you're around you, that God can give you joy unspeakable and full of glory, and he can use you to impact the world? But you know, there are so many times that we live and we believe the lie. But I want to tell you something. There is one principle today. We haven't even dug in the word yet, but we will in just a second. There is one principle that I want to share with you today that has enabled me to seize moments in my life. Now, don't get me wrong. I have missed moments. We all have missed moments. But your past does not have to determine your future. You have a chance today to change the trajectory of your life. If you will be willing to do this one principle, we got one point today. We're going to talk about a couple things, but I got one main point. It'll change your life, and it'll take you places you never thought you'd go, and you'll be able to do things you never thought you'd be able to do. Maybe you're in here, and you're more seasoned. Maybe you're 70 years old, and you think, man, it's over for me. No, it's not. God can use you to do great things today, no matter your background or your situation. So the point we're going to talk about today that I want you to talk about is this. Seize the moment and take a risk. Seize the moment and take a risk. I think I've got a slide up here. If you've got a piece of paper, if you've got notes, a phone. I always talk about a piece of paper. Nobody takes notes hardly anymore except for me. But seize the moment and take a risk. That's what we're talking about today. Turn to your neighbor and say, seize the moment and take a risk. Turn to your other neighbor and say, seize a moment and take a risk. Seize the moment and take a risk. I'm going to try to say that 25 times before I get off stage. Seize the moment and take a risk. For us to seize the moment, we have to be willing to take a risk, not just once, but developing a culture of taking God-inspired risks all the time. So many people in life, we take risks and it don't work out. We never take another risk again for the rest of our lives. Oh, well, that didn't work. That's it.
But I believe the key to my life and the key to people in God's word, reading through God's word, if you look at people in life that have experienced and have done things and impacted the world, it wasn't because they were sitting on their laurels. It was because they were willing to step out and take a risk for Jesus Christ. They were willing to go out and do something different. We're called to be different, folks. We're called to be set apart, unlike the world. We've got to be willing to do what other people aren't willing to do. We got to be willing to go where people are not willing to go. We got to be ready to love people that the world does not want to love. We cannot be like the world and go out and change the world. We can't do it. But what we think is we think we can sit in our pews, we can sit at home, we can walk around in our life and not take risks. We've got to be willing to step in where the world is not willing to step in. We got to be willing to do that. Not making decisions based on what puts the most money in my pocket or what everybody else thinks that I should do. We'll talk a little bit more about my future. I tell you, when I talk to people about where God is taking me and they've seen me preach or they've seen me on video or streaming or whatever, they say, oh, but Pastor Wes, you're such a great speaker. You could have your own church. You could do this. You could do that. It's not about what you think I should do. It's about where the Holy Spirit is taking me. Some of you have been boxed in by what people think you should be or what people think you should do or where you should go. And what I'm telling you today, man, is we got to start listening to the Holy Spirit and blazing a new trail. We got to start listening to the Holy Spirit and being willing to invest where you may not think you see fruit. And we'll talk about why that is in a second. Let's look at Acts chapter 3. If you've got your Bibles, open them up to Acts chapter 3. And we're going to talk a little bit about these situations here in a second. But this is after the death of Jesus. We find two people by the name of Peter and John. I'm going to talk to you in a second about Peter, but he's a great lesson for us. Let's pick up this story in Acts chapter 3, starting at verse 2 and 3. It says, one day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. It says, now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was going to put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John, and Peter said, look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Taking him by the right hand, he helped them up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Now, I want us to go back to that slide that has verse 6 and look at it, but while we're going back to that slide, I want you guys to understand how great Peter is. A great lesson for us. This is a guy who disappointed Jesus in probably the worst way. If you look back later on, Jesus said, you'll deny me 3 times. And Peter said, I will not deny you if I have to die. I will not deny you. But then we find Peter literally cursing himself in the face of persecution, saying, I do not know the man. Many of us in our lives, we have denied Jesus. We have denied Jesus with our lives. We have denied Jesus with our disobedience. He disappointed Jesus and he wept. but he did not let his past determine his future. Some of us here today, we've let God down. We've let Jesus down. But our past does not have to determine our future. Maybe you walked in here today. You feel like you've been a disappointment. Past does not have to determine your future. But let's look at verse 6. Peter says to this man who's crippled, he walks up to him and says, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Peter took an incredible risk in that moment by speaking faith, by speaking in faith what hadn't happened yet and the impossible happened. We read that scripture and we think it was so easy for him to do that. How many of y'all walk up to a crippled man and say, "Hey, man, in the name of Jesus, get up and walk"? Think about that for a second. We just read that scripture and we're like, "Oh, that wasn't a big deal. That was Peter." No. This is a guy that's crippled. How many people do you encounter every day that are blind, that are crippled, that are in need of healing? Do you speak into faith and tell them to get up and walk or to be healed in cancer? No, you don't. Peter took an incredible risk in that moment to speak life into him, to speak something into him that he had faith that God was going to show up on. I would like to think, now this is just me, I could be wrong. I'd like to think that there were times in Peter's life where maybe he did pray for somebody to be healed and it didn't happen. I'd like to think there were times where Peter took a risk and maybe it didn't come to fruition. But it didn't stop him. He spoke life into a situation. Man, it's a great lesson for us. How many times do we get in situations of life and I believe as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ, we should be the most optimistic people on the planet. I really do. I believe when we see people, we need to speak life into them. Listen, Gideon was a coward. We were talking about this weekend. I don't want to bring this up too much, but we read the story of Gideon. This guy is a coward hiding in the basement from his enemies in the Bible. And God addresses him and says, "Hail, mighty warrior." He was nothing like a warrior. He was a coward. But God spoke to him and said, "Hail, mighty warrior." He spoke to Gideon, not as who he was, but as who he was going to be. Reason why I love Jason, reason why I love Pastor Steve, they're speaking life into you. Maybe you're not there yet, but that's not going to stop them from speaking life into you. Not as who you are, but as who you will be. The man, he took a risk. The man that Peter healed, he took a risk. The guy said, "Get up and walk." He didn't even have to try, y'all. He didn't. Maybe there had been times where they had been prayed for before and they said, "Try to get up," and it didn't work. But you know what? This man took a risk by not just getting up, but by running and jumping in the presence of God. How many people would have the courage to do that? That man got up and he wasn't just happy with standing up. He wasn't just happy with a partial victory. That'll preach, right? He wasn't just happy with something fleeting. He wanted something better. He wanted, he wanted the full Monty, right? He wanted everything. How many of us will just settle for what we can get easy? How many times in our lives do we just settle for what is right in front of us instead of taking a risk and stepping out in faith and believing God for what can be? Often, seizing the moment is about getting up and moving towards step one when step two hasn't become clear yet. Sometimes God, a lot of times, God gives us our calling in steps. Just get to this point, and then I'll open up the next point, and then the next point, and then the next point. If you believe God is getting you to Z, go to B. And then once B is there, then maybe see you open up. I remember God had put a calling on my life for full-time ministry, and I moved from Turkey. I lived in Turkey for 2 years. I got stationed there too, man. That wasn't on my dream sheet either, by the way. So, yeah, we moved to Turkey, and we were there for 2 years, 60 kilometers from the Syrian border. Bombs going off. My first son, Reese, was born there. And we got out of the military, and we said, well, you know what? We got some time left, but we'll apply because God has given us a calling to go into full-time ministry, so we're going to apply to get out of the military early. And we had already been in 5 years, and you know what? We got approved for that. So I was like, all right, we got approved. It was a long shot, but we got approved. So that was step B. So then we went to sea. We moved back to the United States, and we believed God had a job for us. And we got here, and we got a house, and then we went and met with Pastor Chad, and he said, I don't have a job for you, but you can serve here with the youth group. And I said, all right, great. Then I'll serve with the youth group. That was step C for me, just get involved and serve in ministry. I did that for 3 years. 3 years I served. I worked a regular job. And then after 3 years, God opened the step for me to go into full-time ministry. By the time I went into full-time ministry, I knew God had put a calling on my life to reach the world. But you know what? Z wasn't there, so we went to D. You just keep progressing as God opens doors. There were times where I took big risks to do that. Here's a question for you to write down today. What are you believing God for, and what risks are you taking to get there? You want to talk about application? That's what you can write down today. That is a question for you today. What are you believing God for, and what risks are you taking to get there? Maybe it's a restored marriage. Maybe it's a financial need. Maybe it's a calling. Maybe it's a loved one that has walked away from the Lord. What are you believing God for? And then what risks are you taking to get there? What are you willing to throw on the altar to get there? Students, what are you believing God for in your future, and what steps are you taking to get there? Are you mad, angry, resentful? So you're just pouting, sitting in your seat? I'm not getting what I deserve, what I want. Once again, guys, I want to talk to you guys a little bit about our personal calling to reach the world. About a year ago, you know, we knew God was moving us. And, you know, we decided at that point a year ago, before we got approved as workers as workers in missions, we decided to let our pastor know and resign from our position. Said, Pastor, in October, it was June. In October, we're applying. It was in June. We said, we're going to apply, and we're going to, in faith, we're going to take a risk. And Pastor, I'm resigning my position. At that point, I hired my replacement, and for a year, I began the application process. And we're not talking about a little tiny application process. We're talking about something that took a year of paperwork, financial records, credit checks. I got my top secret clearance from the military, and it was harder than that. Interviews. Announced it to our congregation in October, still not knowing that I was approved. I told my congregation, we're leaving. And at that point, we began the process to be workers in the Arabian Peninsula, an area where ISIS runs rampant, an area where there are tens of millions of people and not one church. Tens of millions of people who have never heard the name of Jesus one time. I could take the easy route, stayed at my big church, making all that money. I could have taking one of the many offers that was in my face to co-work somewhere else or do something else. I could have taken the easy route, but God had placed a calling on my life, and I was willing to take a risk to get there. Not just a risk of resigning my position, just taking a risk of going somewhere where most people would not go. There are some of you in here, God has put a calling on your life to go places where most people would not be willing to go. Why are you still sitting here in these pews? Why are you not moving forward to where God has taken you? What are you afraid of? Sometimes fear of the unknown is the greatest inhibitor to the move of God in our lives. What are you afraid of? My family and I have got 3 children, 10, 7, and 5. We are headed to a country that has more Starbucks than known followers of Jesus Christ. And we're passionate about it, and we're ready to go. I have gone from getting a paycheck every week to raising money to be sent every week. I don't have to do that. That's my risk. That's my calling. It's not yours. But I believe God has maybe given you something similar. By the way, we will be honored. We put out a blog about every week or two where we just send out emails about people and kind of our journey, because this is a weird journey. Nobody's ever done it. I'll give you an example. There are 2,800 workers being sent out from the Assemblies of God in this country. And as of right now, I believe I am the only African-American AGWM World Missionary in the country. Only one. Because God's called me to be a pioneer. But I believe God's called me also to mobilize people for the field. I believe God's called me to mobilize people to step into their calling, no matter what it is. I was saying we send out an email on our journey, and you know, we'll be out here in the back after service. If you would like to be a part of our email list, we'd be honored to put you on our email list and just keep you guys updated on our journey. It's been amazing what doors God has opened up. I mean, right now, I'll tell you what we're doing this week. We had a beautiful home that we built when we came here back from Turkey, and we've decided we're going to rent that home out. We prayed God to supply a renter. He did, and now we have a week to get out of our home. So when I go back home, this week, my wife and I, we will be painting our house, and we've sold most of our stuff. Our bedroom set has been sold. Our entertainment center, we've sold almost all the furniture in our house because we can't take anything with us, and we're going to downsize and move into a tiny 3-bedroom apartment while we travel and tell people about the calling God has on our lives, because we believe in what God has placed into our heart. We're taking risks. We live a life of taking risks. I want to talk to you guys about 2 real quick things, just that principles that I've lived by in taking a risk, in seizing the moment and taking a risk. The first one is just being aware and being ready. Like, how do you know about a risk? The first one is being aware and being ready. If you look at verse 4, it's that first slide, if we can go back to that, where it says, be aware, be ready. This man said to Peter, he said, the Bible says, Peter looked straight at him as did John, and he said, Peter said, look at this. And it says, the man gave them attention, expecting to get something from them. The man gave Peter his full attention because he was desperate to get something. He didn't want to miss the moment. He thought he was going to get some money in his hand, but he got something better. Does that make sense? Some of us have missed the divine risks on our life, and this is really important, but I didn't want to take it out. Some of us miss the divine moments in our life because we don't have our antenna up. We're not looking or asking God where he wants us to go or what he wants us to do. Does that make sense? That's why, listen, let me tell you something. How hard is it for me to study? The other night I was trying to watch the NCAA tournament and do my sermon notes, and I got nowhere. Why? Because I'm trying to take notes while I'm listening to this guy talk about basketball, and those two things are going to give me interference, right? They're going to give me interference. So what makes us think that the Holy Spirit and God doesn't operate the same way? If we can get up and give God 5 minutes of our time, 10 minutes of our time in his word and prayer and in silence, don't you think he'll speak to us a lot clearly than he will if we just give him whatever we got left over walking through the day? Some of you, the biggest thing in your life right now is you got to give God room to speak into your life. You got to give him your undivided attention. We tell our kids, I need your eyes, I need your undivided attention, but we won't give God his undivided attention. Does that make sense? We've got to be aware and ready, and then God is going to speak those things in your life. There's some of you here, you say, man, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know what risks I'm supposed to take. Well, are you listening? Is your antenna up? I tell students all the time, the most important thing they can do is give God 5 minutes. God can do a lot in 5 minutes, man. Give them five. Maybe the five will become 10. Maybe the 10 will come 15. But listen, give them five. I tell people all the time, give up 5 minutes of your sleep for God and watch him operate. Do it for 1 week. Do it for a month. Watch God begin to speak God moments into your life. You're not going to get it just coming here every Sunday. Looking for opportunities in our day and our lives to serve instead of forwarding our own agenda. How about asking God what he wants us to do? I was struggling over something this morning with my message. And I just took a second and said, God, what do you want me to do? Sometimes we got to practice what we preach. Sometimes it's just, God, where do you want me to go in this situation? God, what do you want me to do in this situation? Sometimes in moments, I'm on the phone dealing with a problem. I just really quickly just, God, where do you want me to go with this? God, I'm here. I'm open. The next one is, real quick, and I'm going to close with this, is make Jesus famous. Make Jesus famous. That's the last thing as far as risk that we're going to talk about. So we want to seize the moment by taking a risk, and we've talked about risk quite a bit, but we want to do this in a couple ways. The first one is we want to be ready, and then the second one is making Jesus famous. And I want to share a scripture with you, and this is a scripture farther down after Peter and John have spoken into this man's life. And then all of a sudden, at this moment, he's kind of, ready for God to operate. God has just done this incredible miracle in his life. Acts chapter 3, verse 16. If you want to read what's in between that, literally, it's just a monologue between Peter and the doubters that were watching, that are in amazement of what God has just done in this guy's life. And this is what Peter says. He says, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is in Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. What I want to tell you this moment about making Jesus famous is Peter and the man left no doubt who was on stage. Peter and the man left no doubt in who was in charge. Oftentimes in our lives, God doesn't have room to operate because we are operating in the physical, where God operates in the spiritual. Very few people really live their faith out loud, but what we miss is that Jesus loves an audience. When we seize the moment by boldly proclaiming Jesus Christ in everything we do, he shows up in ways we never could imagine or dream. I learned a long time ago that the calling Jesus put into my life is not necessarily mine to completely fill. It's my job to be obedient. It's my job to say, God, I'll take that first step, but I can only go as far as you will enable me to go. And then you're going to open up in supernatural ways, and people are going to say, man, I see that guy, Wes. Man, I remember him in high school. He was an idiot. He was a knucklehead. I remember Wes. We used to call him Ash Man. He was a little nerd. I remember Wes. He used to fight with his wife when we were playing games together. Him and his wife would get so upset with each other, they would fight and we would have to leave and they would still be fighting. I remember Wes, he was an angry guy. If you will give God your best and take a risk and allow him to be put on stage, he'll defy logic in you.